new on Curiosity Stream. We've walked with dinosaurs. We've explored our prehistoric planet, and we were always told the same story. Extinction came from the sky. But what if dinosaurs survived? Amazing Dino World 2. Watch it now on Curiosity Stream. With monthly, annual, and bundle plans, find the one that works for you at curiositystream.com.
Did you miss your deadline to renew your Medicaid coverage? You can still send your completed annual review form to Healthy Connections Medicaid. You may be assigned to another health plan, but you can ask to come back to First Choice within 60 days of renewed Medicaid eligibility. It's your family. It's your choice. First Choice is the right choice. Renew and choose us. Visit selecthealthofsc.com/renew to learn more.
Welcome, friends. It's the Movie Boom Podcast. Enjoy the show. Jackie and Brian are talking about the Movie Boom Podcast on the radio.
Welcome to a movie film commentary track. My name is Zaki Hassan, and I'm here with Brian Hall.
Hey, Zaki.
Hey, good morning.
How's it going?
Well, we're spending our time in our quarantine bunkers, celebrating 30 years of Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles.
And almost to the weekend, I didn't realize. It came out March 30th, 1990.
If folks who are listening to this, hopefully this will get you in the mood to join in the celebration with us. And with that in mind, we have a guest joining the celebration with us, and that is Sean Coyle.
Cowabunga, dudes. Yeah, I went there.
you went there early.
I went right to it.
Right to it. That's. I mean, this and all three of us are of the same vintage, and I think people who are in our age bracket have a very specific, special relationship with this movie.
Yes,
mm-hmm. Definitely.
And that's been very interesting for me to see, especially like when you share and talk about it on social media. It's like muscle memory, you know.
Yeah.
I'm sure we'll get into it, but speaking of having memorable theater going experiences, I'm sure each of us has one with this.
Well, mine is not seeing it
at least the first time then.
I watched a bootleg VHS in Saudi Arabia, so that was my
wow,
which was memorable.
Was it called Ninja Turtles or was it called Hero Turtles?
No, it was Ninja Turtles. Yeah.
Okay.
But cool. It was, I mean, I'll talk about that more as we get into it.
Yeah.
But it was a good time, of course. I mean, that tells you something, how widespread the fandom for Ninja Turtles was, that even in Saudi Arabia, it was very popular.
Now, yeah, I mean, this was like a phenomenon. And it's interesting to me how it's carried on to this day. Just it continues to be reincarnated, right?
Yeah.
I mean, Sean, I mean, your kids, well, both your kids, right, are into Ninja Turtles.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, oh, big time.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, actually, that brings up a funny story. But going back real quick to what Brian was talking about, Brian, was this the movie that we realized after like 20 years of friendship that we were there the same day?
Yes, at the same place, yes.
Wow. Yeah, so Stratford Square Mall on opening day.
Yep.
In Bloomingdale, Illinois. I was there with a friend of the show, Zaki, and my childhood chum, Chris Ashline. I was there with Chris Ashline and Heather Black, who is now Heather Manning. And then I'm pretty sure Dave Eddy was there, too. We were there. Somebody's mom took us to the movies and had to sit through it with us, which was...
Yeah, but we described the same scene to each other.
Yeah.
We're like,
yeah.
Oh, yeah, I was out. The line wrapped around the big banister on the second floor.
And yep.
We're like, wait a minute. Yeah. We might have, like, rubbed shoulders that day.
What, you guys are describing, like, two separate flashbacks on Lost. Like each of you has your own stories, and then there's that one moment where you just pass each other, you know?
Yeah. He's like, ooh, freckles. Like, what? I don't even have freckles.
But real quick, because so we're coming up on 30 years of Ninja Turtles, and then tomorrow, we're recording this right now on March 26th. Tomorrow is Brian Hall's 40th birthday.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I'm bringing up birthdays because, Brian, so a couple years ago, my daughter, I think she turned 5 or 6, I don't remember, maybe 6, and Brian asked, what does your daughter, what kind of things is she into? Because he was going to come over for her birthday party. And so jokingly, I described things that I like. I was like, oh, she likes Ninja Turtles and root beer and video games. And so what? So he brings over a gift, and what does my daughter open up but this awesome Raphael Ninja Turtles hat? I was like, oh, man, Brian didn't know I was kidding.
I didn't know until now.
But what's so great is she freaking loves that hat.
Really?
She freaking loves it. She opened it up. She was excited to get it. She wears it. She looks awesome in it. It was cool. So it was a joke that backfired.
That's really funny.
Heartwarmingly so. But it worked out. It all worked out.
Oh, that's great. That cracks me up. I can't believe it.
That's really funny.
Yeah. It made sense. She's your child.
Well, and I just want to mention this for the sake of posterity. We are recording this on my daughter's 3rd birthday.
Oh, wow.
And the tie-in with Ninja Turtles is that when my wife and I found out we were having a girl, on social media I posted a picture of my 4 boys who were all dressed up as Ninja Turtles.
Aww.
And I said, April O'Neil coming. You know, next March, you know.
I don't remember that now, yeah.
I remember that, yeah.
So, obviously, a lot of affinity for the Turtles, and so let's just let's get into it. But before we do that, let's take a short break so that our sponsors can have their say, and then we'll start watching the movie.
Did you miss your deadline to renew your Medicaid coverage? You can still send your completed annual review form to Healthy Connections Medicaid. You may be assigned to another health plan, but you can ask to come back to First Choice within 60 days of renewed Medicaid eligibility. It's your family. It's your choice. First Choice is the right choice. Renew and choose us. Visit selecthealthofsc.com/renew to learn more.
At Grainger, we're for the ones who specialize in saving the day and for the ones who've mastered the art of keeping business moving. We offer industrial-grade supplies for every industry with same-day pickup and next-day delivery on most orders, all backed by real people ready to help so you can get the right answers and products right when you need them. Call, clickgrainger.com, or just stop by. Grainger, for the ones who get it done.
Okay, and we're back, and we're queued up. So, Brian, you ready to go?
Yes. So, I have an interesting scenario over here. You two are watching it on a digital copy, and I'm watching an old DVD copy that I have. And so, putting this out there for people, depending on how you are watching it, if you want to sync it up, for some reason, the DVD copy does not have the New Line Cinema opening page, whatever that is. So, what we decided was most people are probably watching this digitally. We'll have Zachy and Sean queue it up. And you can start with them if you have the New Line opening. And then they are going to queue me up as soon as the image starts. And so that's why we're going to have 2 starts. So
what could possibly
depending on which
go
version
wrong.
You're watching, you can start with Zachy and Sean, or you can start with me.
There we go. All right. Yeah, what could possibly go wrong? Exactly. Okay, let's do this. So we will start playing on 3. Yep. 1, 2, 3, play. So here we go. 1, 2, 3. And here comes this may be the very first time I ever saw the New Line logo.
Yeah, for me this too, is yeah. Sort of like a horror
yes.
shingle at the time, right? With Freddy Krueger and all
exactly.
that.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. And image start.
Yeah, Brian Hall has joined the chat.
Whew. All right.
Man, that was stressful.
Oh yeah? I found it thrilling.
1990
New York.
The majority of the film was actually shot in North Carolina, except for basically this opening.
Lies. Yeah. A little transistor TV or something right there. I love the headlines, by the way. I never noticed them until I rewatched this two nights ago, where it's, you know, like crime wave, and then later it just says it's worse.
So last yep, perfect. Now I know that we're in sync.
Now, what's kind of interesting here is that they introduce Danny right up top.
Yep.
Yeah.
Right away, and you don't necessarily realize, you wouldn't realize at all that he's like one of the most important characters in the movie.
Now, he's never appeared in any of the comics or cartoons or anything, right? He's just made up for the film?
Just for this.
Yeah.
I always wondered how they did this.
This is such a fun gag. I love this. With the truck, with all the boxes, and in one shot without cutting, they pan away, then pan back, and then the boxes.
I mean, doesn't it feel... I noticed this yesterday for the first time. It feels like it freezes on them when they're talking to each other.
Hmm.
I wonder if it was just a facade. And then
the front.
That would make sense.
Yeah. But this is kind of a fun opening. And, you know, okay, so wait. Let's go back a little bit. Like, Batman 89 had just opened, I believe, when they were shooting this, right?
Yeah.
That's right.
So, you know, I was watching this with my girlfriend the other night, who was seeing it for the first time, and I was trying to, like, explain, like, this movie was so cool because it was when this sort of material, like the stuff I liked as a kid, was sort of being treated seriously. Mm-hmm. Like, it was shot like a real film. It wasn't like, I'm going to contradict myself. I was going to say there aren't, like, cartoony noises as people are being bopped on the head. There's a couple. But, like, it takes it very seriously. And it's like,
yes,
right? Like, it's shot like a straightforward, this could be a film for adults as well.
Yes.
And that was cool seeing the turtles in shadows, right? And not just in some brightly lit, fun movie with, like, an upbeat score, right? Like, that, yeah. I remember thinking, like, wow, awesome. Like, this feels like not a grown-up movie, but it just felt like it was being taken seriously. And even as a kid, I felt that.
Yeah, I mean, Brian, to your point, I mean, the previous commentary we did was Batman Forever,
mm-hmm.
which was
mm-hmm.
all about, this is a cartoon, let's treat it like a cartoon.
Right.
And we can see with this film, even though, since it was filming at the same time Batman 89 came out, there couldn't have been an explicit, like, referencing that, but it was that same mentality.
Right.
By the way, the yellow trench coat is like the one nod to...
Yes.
Apparently,
and the colored bandanas,
apparently they had a version of April's jumpsuit for Judith Hogan. She's like, I'm not wearing that.
Yeah, I was reading some fun facts about this last couple of nights, and apparently she didn't have the best time.
No.
Or either she didn't have the best time, or maybe she wasn't the...
Wait, hold on. Let's take a moment to acknowledge future Oscar winner Sam Rockwell.
Sam Rockwell. Bad timing.
In his career-defining performance.
Yeah.
Sorry, you were saying, Sean?
Totally forgot now, because of Sam Rockwell. I got lost in
it. We were talking about the jumpsuit and then
Judith Hogue.
Curvy goatee.
Judith Hogue not having a great time,
Yeah, so apparently, I don't know, depending on kind of what you read, either she had a terrible time making it or they had a terrible time working with her and something didn't click and she didn't return for the two sequels.
Well, it's interesting because from what I read, it was she didn't like the 6-day work week, which is understandable.
Understandable.
And this wasn't like some huge, you know, Warner Brothers production. Like, this was an independent film, and I'm sure they had low budget and just had to make it happen no matter what.
Yeah.
But also, it seemed like she was opposed to all the violence.
Yeah.
Which is interesting because now I mean, I don't know, I wasn't watching it with kids in the room. Sometimes you watch it differently when you have kids in the room, but I was like, man, compared to what we got now,
it
just seems
quaint.
Like people bopping around.
Yeah.
We missed the dam.
We missed the first of many.
I'm sure every 10-year-old is like, FBL just said dam.
Dude, I remember that in the theater. I was like, whoa. I remember as a kid, like, you see that shadowy turtle and you're like, there he is, there he is. And then you hear him say damn and you're like, wait, what?
And then just real quick, I'll just say, as long as we're talking about the sort of the violence, Jim Henson apparently didn't appreciate it either.
Wait, hang on one sec, Brian. Right here.
Yep.
I still remember being, whatever I was, 11 years old, I think, when this came out, or 10 going on 11. No, 11 years old. when that logo flew on the screen, like the audience just went nuts. Like all the kids, I still remember those, like that tingly feeling of like, holy crap, this is real. This is a real thing.
The fact
you know
that
that's
it was
cool too.
Go ahead, Brian.
Yeah, go ahead.
I just the fact that it was the logo. It wasn't. Like,
I was just gonna say. Yep.
Yeah.
Because it's like when He-Man came out and all these other movies. It's like they try to rebrand it and they make up new characters and they have new logos and new costumes. You're like, no. Mm-hmm. Like this was the logo. That's why I came.
Yeah.
You know. It,
yeah.
It's cool when they do that.
Now, I think the costumes, I think the animatronic, the suits and everything, I think they look pretty badass in this movie.
They still do. Too.
They still do.
The two sequels that followed, not so much, especially the third one is garbage. But, I think they look great.
Yeah, real quick, I just got to call out the credit. Sally Menke, this was her first editing credit. That's mostly known for being Quentin Tarantino's editor before she passed.
So now, director Steve Barron, who directed it, I'm sure you guys looked this up too, but he was a big music video guy. He worked on the Dire Straits Money for Nothing video, which was very popular back in the day. Bryan Adams' Cut Like a Knife, Africa by Toto, a bunch of stuff with Madonna, ZZ Top, Culture Club, Don Henley, David Bowie. And Zaki, if you didn't know this, he was the camera assistant on Richard Donner's Superman.
Huh. No kidding. I didn't know that.
Yeah. So kind of an interesting... kind of a fun sounding career.
Yeah.
Leading up to this. And then I think the only other feature he directed after this was the Coneheads movie.
Wow.
Well, that's unfortunate.
I haven't seen that since the theater. Speaking of theaters.
Right, had that really Red Hot Chili Peppers song in the soundtrack. And we're like,
yeah.
What?
Is that Soul to Squeeze?
This is Kevin Clash.
Too.
Yeah. That's Kevin Elmo. Clash. It's Splinter.
As the Elmo. Voice of Splinter,
No, just look how expressive his body language is. Michelangelo on the phone. Like, he's the relaxed one, and he's being silly. And I feel like it's amazing what they are able to wring out of these probably constricting costumes.
So the voice of Michelangelo over there on the phone is Robbie Rist, who people might know as Cousin Oliver from the Brady Bunch.
If anyone crazy.
Still remembers the Brady Bunch.
So funny.
The clock's ticking, dude.
But they weren't, the voices and the actors inside the costumes were not the same people, correct?
Except
only
for Raph.
Yeah.
Okay.
Except for Raph. And we see the actor later in the film.
What the heck was that?
Yeah. That's pretty good. Yeah.
It's, you know, you're talking about the personalities and how they come through even through the performances. Like, I think in a lot of ways, Ninja Turtles as a concept is a generation, like the way people plugged into it was a generational marker, because I remember contemporaneous reviews of this movie being like, what's the only difference between them is the color of their bandanas and that. And it's like, you ask any kid to describe the Turtles and they'll say the color last.
Yeah.
Yep.
They're like, oh, Leonardo is like this, and you know, Mikey is the party one. And I mean, it's all there from the song. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Absolutely. And then that's, you know, rewatching it as an adult too. I kind of admired that it wasn't just four dudes working together. I mean, you've got this rift between Leonardo and Raphael that creates a bond between Donatello and Michelangelo because they don't want to be around them fighting. And I just never really thought much about that till I got older, and I was like, wow, that's really good. So they have their own little bonds within the group.
Corey.
The dude's got 30 seconds.
Mm-hmm. Corey Feldman. Nice.
Corey Feldman, yeah.
Yeah, who I read he only got paid $1,500 to do this.
Really?
I think so he was working on some small film that went on to make, I guess, over $135 million.
Yeah, at the time, it was the highest grossing independent film, right?
Yep.
You're just about to say that, weren't you?
No. This is great. So now this is another one of the turtle actors, right? I think this is Michelangelo.
He's Michelangelo.
The Domino's delivery guy.
Yep.
Nice product placement.
I just saw
this,
by the way, and I don't know if it was targeted because I just watched it, but I got a Fandango ad that said that the Ninja Turtles were practicing social distancing before it was cool, and they played this scene.
Oh, really?
Yeah. That's funny.
Yeah.
That's unnerving, actually, Brian, the fact that... Like your Fandango
the
new.
Very 30-year-old movie I just watched was used for that ad. Yeah, I know. It's crazy. Hey, give me that.
This is a 10. The tab's 13. You're 2 minutes late, dude. Oh, come on. I couldn't find the place.
Wow. Okay. I didn't know this is what we were doing for the next 90 minutes.
That's going to be the other track.
This is divine. Never pay full price for late pizza.
I got to get a new route.
I thought I delivered everywhere.
And so, scene.
The new Turbo Ginsu. Oh, my God. I could just keep going.
Yeah, yeah, right. I don't think people tuned in for this.
You know, this movie, you got to appreciate the editing, because I'm sure there were limitations. If we could watch the full takes of this, of what those suits could do and what, you know. But it's cut so tightly. It reminded me of The Matrix, which I rewatched lately. It's just cut so precisely to sell everything we're watching.
Right.
Yeah, you know, like, this is a really well-made movie.
Well, to your point, it reminds me of when you look at, like, outtakes from The Empire Strikes Back, where Yoda doesn't quite look right, you know?
Right.
And they had to pick the exact take where you just forget he's a puppet, you know?
Mm-hmm. Now, wasn't this whole script kind of cobbled together from, or not cobbled, but I mean, this was from the comics, a lot of the major plot points in this, right?
Like various issues and storylines, yeah.
Yeah, like from the foot infiltrating the sewers to them going to April's farm, like that came from the comics.
Yeah.
Yes, but they merged it with elements of the cartoon.
Right.
And so it's kind of this really unique mixture because you know, the colored bandanas and things like that, that's from the show.
Right.
And so they found a way of you know, the movie is much darker than the show, and yet you're never like, well, that's not what it's like. Like, you never feel like not watching the Ninja Turtles, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Remember Casey Jones in the cartoon was like a Clint Eastwood knockoff?
Yes.
Ooh, you lawbreakers.
Yeah.
In this movie, he's just like a psychopath.
Right.
It's like, come on, those kids were already beat up. What the...
I should mention here that thanks to California being on shutdown, I haven't been able to get my hair cut in a while, so I'm in full Elias Koteas as Casey Jones mode right now.
Yes.
My hair is like out of control.
That's hilarious. Are you a punker?
So you know, watching this movie, I'm reminded all over again how much I loved Elias Koteas. Not just in this role, but just about anything he's ever done.
Yeah, mm-hmm. He was because of this movie, and ever since, he's been one of those guys that he shows up in something, and you're just excited to see him.
You're happy to see him.
Yeah.
Yeah. Wait, can we go back real quick? What was the Critters reference earlier? Where it's not like he's just walking out of it; he comments on it, Raphael. I mean, is that related to anything, or it's like a dig at something? Or,
well, I'm wondering if Critters was a New Line
movie.
Movie.
There was a version. I don't know if it was scripted or if it was shot where, like, he walks out of seeing Batman, right? And he makes some sort of comment about, like, how silly the costume was or something like that.
Yeah, like cool car, bad costume or something.
Yeah, yeah.
Hmm. And then Warner's was like, nay.
Well, New Line picked it up for, like, it was produced independently, and yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
Here he comes.
Oh, yeah.
What the heck was that?
Josh.
You did it almost exactly in sync.
That was impressive.
That's perfect.
That's Josh Pays, yeah. The actor who plays Raphael.
And he was on a podcast, a wonderful podcast I think our listeners would love, called I Was There Too.
Yeah.
And he talked about how the director was eventually let go because there were concerns that the movie was too dark.
Really?
And I don't know. If you ask me, it's like the perfect. It's just about perfect because it never gets gruesome. Like it still, to me, feels like a kid's movie, but it's a kid's movie that's like, hey, kids, let's like watch this thing that'll make you feel like we're taking your thing seriously.
Yeah. Now, Zachy, correct me if I'm wrong, but didn't Roger Ebert like this movie? I remember like it used to be like a thing where you would read in the papers, you'd look at to see what like Roger Ebert and Gene Siskel gave these movies. And I remember this one getting like 3 stars or something like that. And it felt like a validation, like, see, see everybody.
Well, he gave it 2.5 stars.
2.5.
And my sense is he wasn't a huge fan. I mean, think about this here. He says the plot. Do you care? It involves a TV. Like,
But still, it wasn't one star. It wasn't one.
It was, right, right. It wasn't a complete dismissal.
This is we're taking half a loaf.
That's hilarious.
This is what Roger Ebert says. Now comes Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles the movie. I did not walk into the screening with a light step and a heart that sang. For that matter, I did not walk out afterward with my spirits renewed. But this movie is nowhere near as bad as it might have been and is probably the best possible Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles movie.
I'll see when you're 11 years old. That sounds like a rave
right,
review.
Right.
Well, I mean, I will say, given that we have, what, like 6 Ninja Turtles movies, I think he's right in that it is probably the best one.
Still the best one, yeah.
You know what? And I would still say this is one of the best comic book adaptation movies ever, too.
I fully agree. I absolutely agree. Yeah.
Yeah, totally respects its material. And
I mean, I think what we really see is how, at this time, certainly, movies had to work within the limitations. You know, I mean, you could not have Bebop and Rocksteady or Krang.
Right.
And that wasn't the movie you were going to get. And it's weird how, as kids, we were just like, well, yeah, of course you can't do that.
Right.
You know,
even in the second one, even in Secret of the Ooze, when it was like you got Toka and Razar, and you're kind of like, well, why not Bebop and Rocksteady?
Yeah. I wonder if that was
like...
Do
you think it's because they couldn't make them speak?
I thought that might have been like a rights issue, like those characters aren't available.
Oh, maybe, yeah.
Danny.
bad kid.
Taking so money.
I forget where I read this, but somebody online equated this guy who plays Charles as the poor man Stephen Tobolowsky.
Poor guy.
And so I'm watching it thinking that it's Stephen Tobolowsky, and I like it a whole lot more.
Oh, that's funny.
That's really funny.
Blustery police chief.
Blowing his hot air.
Yeah. Well, just being a little indulgent. So opening weekend, I just remember being completely enamored with this. And when you brought up Siskel and Ebert, that reminds me of what it was like. You know, when you couldn't look up clips online, I would look forward to Siskel and Ebert if it was a movie that I loved, like Last Crusade or this, because I'd get to see clips from the movie again.
Exactly.
You remember that?
Yep.
And so then after seeing this at Stratford, I remember my mom took me. We went straight to Suncoast Video, and she bought me the movie poster. So I had this poster of them poking their heads out from the sewer.
I had that too.
Yeah, it's such a memorable.
How funny.
Maybe our moms went to the same Suncoast Video and bought the
maybe
poster.
Right. And I probably went to that Suncoast to then buy the VHS when it came out.
They're in their own lost flashbacks.
Yeah. I gotta digress real quick before we get to some more action. So this was a movie that when it came out, I was just insane into Ninja Turtles, and this was one of those instances where like my dad made a really conscious effort to try to be like hip to what I was into. So he was the one that read it in the newspapers, like, hey, did you know that movie was actually filmed in North Carolina and not in New York?
That's
great. So, and then when I moved out to California back in 2003, we drove out together from Chicago, and we were just kind of like, you know, we were just exploring the territory, and we saw all those houses up in the Hollywood Hills and stuff like that. And I made some comment like, oh, well, I'd hate to live in one of those houses during a mudslide or something. And he goes, yeah, or like Mel Gibson in a pickup truck. And I was like, I kind of looked at him, and he had this grin on his face like, yeah, we like the same stuff.
That's cool.
Yeah. It was just like, what? He's so cool. So why is a New York City subway totally empty at this time of day?
Well, really, I mean, by later in the movie, all of New York is basically empty. You've got like a ninja battle in the streets and just nobody's around.
That's true.
Oh, yeah, you're totally right.
So this actor right here, he's the puppeteer for Donatello.
Okay.
Yeah.
We've been waiting for you, Miss O'Neill. I deliver a message.
I like how she looks at his hand. Like, what is it?
I know.
What's in your hand?
Yeah, what is it? Okay, sorry, I'm just watching the movie.
Yeah.
Well, let's talk about the foot also, because the foot in the cartoon, they were robots, right?
Well, that was because you couldn't have, like, actual violence against people.
Yeah, and Leonardo's swords are a little bit limiting in a kid's setting.
Now, the foot itself, and I'm sure a lot of people listening already know this, but I mean, Ninja Turtles was basically a big homage to Daredevil from the Marvel comics.
Yeah.
And, right. Yeah. Let's talk about that. The whole inception here.
So, Zachy,
sorry, real fast, and then jump to Daredevil. But just in case he's listening, I remember Chris Ashline as a kid, how that POV of Raphael running towards the ninjas just drove him crazy.
Oh, why?
I don't know. That's just something that just popped in there. I was like, Chris Ashline hated that shot.
So, oh, that's so funny.
I remember. All right, Daredevil. Go ahead, Daredevil.
Yeah, so both Peter Laird and Kevin Eastman were just big fans of what Frank Miller did on Daredevil in the mid-80s, or early to mid-80s, you know, with heavy ninja influence. And you had, in Daredevil, you had the Hand. That was a ninja clan. So the foot was a, you know, it was a pastiche of that.
Mm-hmm.
And even, like, the ooze that the turtles were created from was supposed to be the same ooze that hit Matt Murdock gave him his superpowers, and then it went into the sewer.
Oh, wow.
So there's, like, several levels. Oh, and even Splinter, right? The ninja master who trained Daredevil, his name is Stick.
Stick, right.
So he's Splinter, you know? But it's just funny how, I mean, that's how something starts. It's like, hey, it's like this wink nudge thing that, hey, I mean, you know, it was a comic with like a 500 issue print run or something crazy.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, you cut to almost 40 years later, and like, who does not know at least the concept of Ninja Turtles everywhere on Earth?
Yep.
I mean, you just don't know, you know?
That's one of the things that I love about that series on Netflix, The Toys That Made Us.
Yes.
Because a lot of them have to do with the TV shows that we loved growing up. And it's just amazing that every single episode is basically the toy company was interested in something entirely different that no one probably would ever care about. But then there was this one rogue little misfit thing, you know, like IP, like in this case, the Turtles. And we know it's going to become a phenomenon, but you realize just how close it was to never happening, and it was just so unlikely, and it's just amazing that that's always the case, and that was the case with this, right?
I mean, especially when you consider that from the comic first being published to the movie, you're looking at about 7-8 years, which is an insanely fast turnaround for something like that, right?
Right.
And that's, the fact that the 90s were basically overrun with comic book adaptations of a lot of like indie or lower level properties was a result of this, of Ninja Turtles.
Yeah.
That's the reason Men in Black happened. That's the reason, I mean, gosh, like Tank Girl and like all the, you know what I mean?
Right.
Wow. Yeah.
Judge Dredd, right? That was a comic too, right?
Judge Dredd is another one. Yeah.
That was us. Ow. His little shrug. I'm just blown away, honestly, by just their eyes and their body language. Yeah. But they're able to pull off of these. I lose myself in this. Like, I don't see four costumes. You know, they feel like personalities to me. But maybe I'm crazy.
So this is more of the comic book adaptation, right? No. This is more. Wait, I get these confused all the time. So in the comic books, Splinter was the pet of Hamato Yoshi.
Correct.
Mm.
But in the animated series, Splinter is Hamato Yoshi.
In the 80s one, yeah.
Yeah.
I forgot about that. Yeah.
Because they go back and forth, because there was a 2000s animated show where Splinter was the pet.
Right.
And then in the CGI show on Nickelodeon, he's the Ninja Master again.
Yeah. And apparently that footage of them as little turtles, that was shot by Brian Henson on 8mm film.
Yeah.
Really?
Mm-hmm. I'm not dreaming, am I?
Isn't that amazing that that's Elmo? It's just so the contrast.
And the voice of Leonardo, I don't think we mentioned, is Brian Tochi, who people might remember as as Takashi. The Asian fellow from Revenge of the Nerds.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah. Wow. I didn't know that.
Yeah.
No, I didn't know that either.
11th and Bleecker? Nope, this is only 9th Street.
So this looks like a backlot to me, but what do you guys think?
Well, this was I don't have it up in front of me, but I think this was the bankrupt, at the time it had just become the bankrupt Dino De Laurentiis studio.
Oh, okay. Mm.
And so, like, the state owned it maybe at this point.
Okay.
And that's why they were giving, you know, these, the Hollywood movie studios, these gigantic tax breaks, basically like, come and shoot your movie for free, you know?
Right. But I totally get what you're saying, Zachy, especially because of the way it looks just like a building blocking your view from anything.
Yes, right?
Yeah. It was a joke.
Now, Zachy, did your kids know who what the James Cagney impression was?
No, they had no idea. They got the Rocky reference.
Of course, right.
But the, this is very funny you bring that up, yeah, because they were just kind of like, okay. But that's, I mean, that's worth pointing out is, you know, I've watched this movie with the kids before, so they've seen it, but like, you know, they just, at this point, they are familiar with so many different interpretations of the Turtles that it's not like, oh, this is the real one and this is the fake one. You know, they don't think in those terms. Right. They're just like, oh, this is this version.
Yeah.
Right.
And it was, I was watching them watch the movie and they're just fully like, they're just carried away, you know? And I think that goes to the, how the movie fully embraces its own reality.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't wink at the audience and say, look how ridiculous this is.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know, and I think that's so crucial because that's what allows us 30 years later to be swept up by it again.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You know?
So, yeah, I mean, this versus like they just buy into the puppets, even though they may be more used to CGI looking.
Yes.
Creations these days.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I would make the analogy of like these kids are able to watch Christopher Reeve as Superman and Henry Cavill as Superman.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah.
And they don't, you know, even though Henry Cavill has access to more sort of technical, you know, special effects and things like that, that they don't look down at the 78 one.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. You know what I wonder helps too as I'm watching this and it looks grainy, yes. Right? I mean, it looks like it was clearly shot on film. And I really do think that helps, right? It adds that sort of cinema magic to it. And I wonder if this was shot the way it would have been shot today when it's just, you can see every pore on every actor, if it might feel a little bit less removed from, you know, the magical realm and more like, oh, wow, I can see the creases. I can see the zipper, you know?
Right. Yeah, no, that's a good point.
Yeah.
I mean, if you guys remember, they did a live action television series.
Yep.
Called The Next Mutation.
Right.
And I'm sure they were counting on, oh, you know, they've done like 3 feature films already, so people can know what to expect. And yet it looked awful.
Right.
Yeah, that's the thing. The films got worse. Drastically worse.
Yeah, I mean, I have no memory of the third one.
Yeah. Well, even the second one was sort of a response, right, to this one, where they don't really use their weapons very often.
Yeah.
Right.
Like, it opens in a toy store, and they're using, like, little bot balloons and sausages hanging from counters.
Which is weird, right? Because I can understand that on some level because, yeah, when you have kids, you don't want them taking the wrong lesson. But on the other hand, I'm just like, I mean, I've got 4 boys who are all roughly in the Ninja Turtle demo, and none of them has been tempted to create their own nunchuck, you know?
Yeah.
Mm.
So, I go back and forth because there's definitely that side of me where I'm like, as a parent, yeah, I want to make sure that they're not taking the wrong lessons. But I'm also like, you know, people are way too, like, they don't give kids enough credit either.
Mm.
Well, I remember when the cartoon was current, when it was happening, because ninjas, either, I don't know if it's like just ninja weaponry or something about ninjas, was basically banned in like the UK.
Yes.
So that's why over there it was called Hero Turtles. And that's why they also changed Michelangelo's nunchucks to that grappling hook thing in those later seasons.
In the cartoon. Mm. Yeah.
Yeah. In the cartoon. Yeah.
Well, and speaking of that, I mean, you know, Michelangelo's like nunchuck competition and this was just cut out of the European releases.
Yeah. Which is one of the highlights of the movie, right?
Yeah, I know. It's a shame.
Yeah, it's so funny. Huh. You know, it's funny too, though, when you think about it, when this came out, this was squarely aimed at kids, right?
Yeah.
But then as we grew up, we wanted to continue watching comic book things. So as we aged, it's like the intensity of those movies aged with us. And now, you know, you have people being like, why aren't Ninja Turtles rated R? We're ready for it. You know, but it's like, no, wait, remember this started for kids.
That's kind of funny, yeah, because you know, in this you have the scenes where, like, they're watching April on TV and they're like, she's a babe, right? And then I remember, like, the 2014, the Michael Bay produced one, where they're like, my shell is getting tight, and one of them's like, I'm gonna go jerk off or whatever, you know, like,
right.
I don't think he says that, but it's like it like elevates it to the point where you're like, ew,
no, yeah.
So this is supposed to be like an homage to the Lost Boys and Peter Pan, right?
Oh yeah, what are they called? That's Peter Pan. Yeah, I was thinking Pinocchio. Yeah. I read somewhere too about the Island of Misfits or whatever it is.
Yeah, whichever one.
With the cigars, like kids with cigars hanging out of their mouths and
regular pimento.
Got any cigarettes? Now, at the time, I remember being a kid and like not liking kid actors, like some of these actors, like Goonies was its own thing. But like, I remember when I saw this, you know, when I was much younger, I was like, I kind of hate Danny.
Yeah.
Danny's a wiener. I don't like Danny. Now I don't care. Like, whatever. But like, how do you guys, were you the same way back then?
Absolutely.
Like, did kid actors drive
when they
crazy?
Shoved like a made up kid character in a movie just because they thought I needed a kid to like identify with? I'm like, no, I'm here for the turtles.
Yeah. Well, I mean, we've had several commentaries where I'm just like, dumb kid. So that's
it. It's funny though, how you're right with Goonies. I was like, no, I want to hang out with those guys.
It helps that they were all of them good actors.
Yeah. Yeah.
Master Tatsu.
I remember,
my brother and I still say this to each other. Never lower your voice to an enemy.
Just when you think about it, I mean, the distinctions between Shredder's approach and Splinter's approach is a little bit like Karate Kid, where you have Miyagi-Do and Cobra Kai, right? It's I was thinking about that yesterday as I was watching it. But speaking of Tatsu, I remember I lived in Saudi Arabia at the time, and we came to visit the States that summer, so it would have been just a few months after this movie had come out, and I got the Topps trading cards.
Mm-hmm.
And that was really the first time I got like a good close look at what the turtles look like, and I remember Tatsu was like one of the cards. I was like, who's that guy?
Oh yeah. Yeah, that shot, by the way, with Shredder entering in that long shadow, you saying that this director came from music videos, I was like, yeah, I mean, this movie's got a real sense of style to it
for sure. Yeah, absolutely.
Interesting. Yeah.
And as silly as it is, I do admire that they're not like just trying to come up with new fight sequences for them. Like you were saying, that there's a duality between Shredder's approach and Splinter's approach. Like, there's they put some thought into this, and that's why we probably still, even as adults, can like enjoy it.
So like,
aside from the memories,
are all these kids supposed to be like destined to become foot soldiers at some point?
It's at least recruitment, right? I mean, some of them might not have what it takes, but it's like a way to sort of lure them in, I imagine.
Yeah.
Yeah, clearly, like, it's a big deal when one of them gets the Dragon Doji, right?
Yeah.
I wonder what they do to the kids who don't make it, though. You know, like,
they kill them.
Yeah, later.
Right? Because there's one kid who was supposed to technically be dead, but the movie...
Yeah, that's right.
...wussed out a little bit.
Movie was that a little bit.
They didn't murder the child.
Right.
Pussies.
G.I. Joe the movie, right? Remember Duke was supposed to die? Duke clearly dies in the
Yes. Well, they something similar in this, yeah, exactly.
There's Sam Rockwell again.
Oh yeah.
Now going back to our kids for a second, obviously, like, predictably my son, his favorite character is Leonardo. When you ask him who his favorite Ninja Turtle is, because he's the leader and he's got the swords. And then you ask my daughter and she's like, I like Donatello. And I think to myself, good. You know, we should all want our daughters to
In case there was any subtlety, in case there was any subtlety about who the Shredder is inspired by, you have him say, "I am your father."
I am your father.
Yeah.
I remember Roger Ebert bringing that up in his TV review.
Really?
Comparing him to Darth Vader.
Yeah, the boys watching yesterday, they're like, "Why is his voice so deep?" And I'm like, "Because he's the Shredder, duh."
It's funny, by the way, Sean. I thought both your kids, or at least one of them, might say Michelangelo just because he's the funniest.
Right, right.
Yeah, each of my boys has their favorite, and it just happened to work out that it's a separate one, you know?
Oh, nice. Brilliant.
So my oldest likes Leonardo. My second, who you guys know, no surprise, his favorite is Raphael.
Now, do you think the older boys just decided for the younger boys, or at least the youngest? Like, no, you get Donatello.
I wonder, you know?
Oh, that's funny.
You know, one thing I did wonder about is, like, when the turtles show up in her apartment, I mean, they live in the sewer. They must smell awful.
That's a good point. I love, by the way, when she wakes them up that one morning, how they're sort of in their shells.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Like, curled up on the ground.
Another random piece of trivia that there's three reporters who are referred to by name, and they are April, May, and June.
Oh, yeah. April, May, and June, yeah.
Oh, right. That's funny. Poor Tobo right there. Getting an earful from the police chief.
So these are always, like, these are always just kind of bunk, whatever kind of facts, but, like, when they list, like, the people considered, quote unquote,
yes,
for these different roles. So I've got here for Casey Jones, Johnny Depp, Keanu Reeves, Christian Slater, Lou Diamond Phillips, Emilio Estevez, Kiefer Sutherland, Jason Patrick, Brian Austin Green, Alex Winter, Gary Daniels, and River Phoenix were all considered for the role of Casey Jones.
They cast a wide net.
And then Jennifer Beals, Marissa Tomei, Sandra Bullock, Nicole Kidman, Melanie Griffith, Sean Young, Lorraine Bracco, Winona Ryder, and Brooke Shields were all considered for the role of April O'Neil.
I love how you can say anybody was considered. Oh, Meryl Streep was considered.
Right.
John Williams was considered as the composer for Ninja Turtles. And
I mean, I believe that Marissa Tomei and Sandra Bullock.
I can see that, yeah.
Because especially in terms of where they were in terms of their career back then, that would make sense.
Yeah. You can just hear this. So that's the plan from our great leader. Is that Finley? Oh, I think Sean's tending to his dog.
Sean's dog.
I'm happy
dog,
he made
Finley.
A cameo.
There you go.
Yeah. Sorry, I had to let the dog into the room.
Yeah. That's all.
He's here now.
Pork rind.
Pork rind.
Yeah, like mommy and daddy are fighting. So they bond. Hey, we get another Raph Dam.
Another Dam. We got Casey Jones, who coincidentally just happens to be.
I was like, what are the sheer odds of that? In New York, that he just happens to.
He's got his binocs.
Yeah.
I'm amazed how limber those actors can be in those costumes.
Yeah. It's obvious later the building in a little bit that catches fire is a different building.
Yeah, right.
But that was the iconic superhero shot, the hero looking over the city.
Mm-hmm.
You know, speaking of being limber in the suits, I was reading about how earlier in the film, you know, when Raph, like, lands in the trash can, the stuntman broke his nose.
Ooh.
Because of the mechanisms inside the helmet.
Oh, that's horrifying.
So he takes it off, his nose is broken. Can you imagine that?
No. Jeez. Having that machinery squashed on your face?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, I'd read somewhere too that they said having their heads in there, I mean, it sounded like an echo chamber of machinery, and I just don't think about that, but that must have been really a, I don't know, almost kind of claustrophobic in there.
Yeah, well, the actor who played Raphael, Josh Pais, he basically, like, every 20 minutes he had to take the thing off
because
he was just going crazy, you know?
Yeah. I wish, you know, they probably didn't do behind the scenes back then like they do today, but I would love to see a shot behind the camera and just what it looks like, how many people have remote controls,
mm-hmm, for sure, right?
What it sounds like on set.
Yeah, because you imagine that there were separate people who were manning the mechanisms for the mouth to make sure it was working in sync with the dialogue.
Mm-hmm. And the eyes. And now I think about it, April doesn't sound looped. Like you would think that maybe their costumes were making a bunch of noises, and then the whole movie she'd have to sound like she was in another room.
That's a good point. Wow, yeah.
Look at it. It's just incredible what they're able to do in these outfits.
Yeah.
Raph fighting the foot on the roof. Good answer. Good answer. Now, this is this a thing? Like, I don't know a ton of stuff from the comics, like April having this place and their junk shop and all
that.
Sean, that
might be something you know better than, yeah.
You know, how closely did you follow the different iterations of the comics, from the original black and white to the Archie comics? To...
I was first exposed to this by the toys. I remember walking into a Venture store and just seeing these on the shelves and thinking I must have
I think
those.
I had that same experience, Venture specifically. Maybe we were in each other's flashback.
Yeah.
And then it became like, you know, it went from the toy to the cartoon, and then it was like a fun fact for a while. Like, hey, you know, this was actually a comic book first.
Right.
So then my first job was actually working at a comic book store. And so I... I bought a bunch of the back issues of this and
of the the Mirage Studios.
Yeah, yeah, okay. The Mirage Studios one. And you know, it's obviously very, very different than what I had experienced up until then.
Right, very bloody.
So I never did a deep dive into the comic books. I know the farmhouse was part of it.
Yes,
like that was something that had always been there. You know, the arcs that I had read never really dealt much with other mutants or anything like that. And I don't know if those books ever did. The Archie comics were the fun ones to read.
Yeah. So Sean is talking about, there was a series called Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles Adventures, which was published by Archie. And really, like, there was that led to a whole line across, you know, different, you know, DC and Marvel would do adventures books that are like kid targeted versions of their property. So you had like Batman Adventures based on the animated series and X-Men Adventures, but you know, but it started with Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle Adventures from Archie, which was, it was not technically based on the animated show.
Well, the first like five issues are like kind of a loose adaptation of that mini,
but then it just
kind of
did its own thing after that.
Yeah. And they were given permission. They were basically given permission by, I don't know if it was Eastman or Laird or who, but they were like, given permission to kind of do your own thing.
Can you imagine if they hadn't, you know, when this cartoon was presented to them and it was like, well, it's going to be much lighter, it's gonna be very different, they could have been like, well, that's not what we're doing, and we don't want to compromise. And I mean, just imagine what wouldn't have happened. Well, it's interesting too, I've never noticed this till now, but they seem to have different masks on when they're not speaking and they're fighting. They're a little less expressive.
Makes sense.
Yeah, it's noticeable when Michelangelo was doing the nunchuck thing. Just
I never noticed that till right now.
How funny.
I always like that the guy he's doing the nunchuck battle with is like, oh.
Yeah, he's impressed. Yeah. A fellow chucker.
So where was this guy with the axes? Somebody online.
By the van.
Yeah, pointed this out.
The axe van. He's getting axes, man.
It took him longer to get up there. There's a lot of axes.
Yeah. He was probably like grumbling under his breath.
He's
as he
like
went
lugging
up,
several like knapsacks of axes, you know?
He's like an intern at this point, but he's earning his way.
He's the toe.
Yeah. Yes. which was your first turtle action figure? Who did you get first?
I had Raphael and Donatello, and they were the original versions that had the squishy heads.
Yep.
So Raph was my first also.
Me too.
That's really weird, you guys.
Yeah.
And my experience with Ninja Turtles was I like Sean, I went to Venture. It must have been like summer of 89 maybe, and I was like, what the hell is this? You know, and I didn't I was like, Ninja Turtles, what? And then I went back to Saudi Arabia, and I had, you know, I went to an American school at the, oh no, so you know what, this would have been summer of 88 now that I think about it. And a friend was like, no, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles is awesome. I was like, oh, okay, I guess it's awesome, you know? That's what you do when you're a kid. And so my next trip then, I did the thing where I looked at all four and I read the little, the bio sheets on the back. I was like, turtle with forked tongue, I remember, was Raph's. I was like, I guess I'm getting this guy. And the squishy head was a friggin' piece of shit because the head just came off.
Popped off. I remember that. I remember taking it off and putting it back on.
Yeah.
Yeah. I love this, by the way. It's like so small, but just Casey, like, what are you doing to my friend over there? You're like, aw. Yeah. He's looking out for him, his bud.
Oh, Dirk.
You know, this is all the, you know, it's nothing insanely spectacular, but at least they're not doing that shaky cam where you can't tell what's going on.
Yeah.
Nothing may as well be going on. Like, it's actually kind of choreographed this and shot it and cut it well.
Well, and when you think about it, I mean, this is relatively speaking, it's very small scale. And yet this is the big action set piece for Act 2.
Yeah, and we've talked about this, but it's good escalation because it doesn't require you then jumping onto an airplane and then doing this and whatever. It's like they start in one location and then the floor falls out. And it's like, you know, they're in the same spot, but it just keeps getting bigger and bigger and bigger. Yeah. And then you add fire to the same location. And it's how do we stay where we are but make it more and more threatening?
So we just passed it, but I remember it's an error in the movie where they show that shot of Donatello sort of punching the guy in the face and spinning away. They show it twice.
Oh, really?
They show it, then they come back to Leonardo, and then they show again, and it's a slightly longer take of the same shot.
Oh, that's funny.
Yeah.
And yet, until just now, I would not have even thought about it.
No, same. Never noticed it.
So thank you for ruining my childhood, Sean.
You're very welcome.
So here's the party wagon, or the equivalent thereof.
Right. Yeah.
And this is the funny thing. Like, when you're a kid, you're just like, yeah, okay, that's the party wagon.
Right. Yeah.
You're not like, why doesn't it shoot pizzas or whatever, you know?
I forgot about that.
Danny, this is your fault, you bastard. Yeah, I hope you feel bad.
That's why I didn't like Brian's brother the first time I met him.
Danny. And then once you did start liking him, were you like, no, it's just Dan now.
Just Dan now, okay.
I still don't see it when I'm watching it, but they were saying that to disguise how, you know, wonky the costumes could look, they shot at different varying frame rates.
Right.
The action and their dialogue.
I read that.
But I don't, I mean, so minuscule. Second. I think it's 23 frames versus 24, but it's, I don't know. I'd be kind of curious to see the original footage, how much slower it looks.
But I just want to point something. I love how Shredder goes in there and he threatens Splinter. He's like, how did they know how to fight like this? As opposed to being like, how are you a giant talking rat? Like, that's not...
Right.
Like, he's focusing on the wrong thing.
Right.
So right here, it was supposed to be that Tatsu kills this kid who comes at him.
Yeah.
And supposedly in the novelization, he does die.
That's correct, yeah.
Yeah, because all of it is handled off screen, right? You hear ADR of like, he's gonna be all right. You
know? It is. It's like Sean. It's like G.I. Joe the movie.
Yeah.
He's gone into a. We see a character get stabbed in the heart in G.I. Joe the movie.
Through the heart, like, and then through one, out, in the back, out the heart.
Like, yeah. And it's like, like he's gone through. Into a coma.
Yeah. While we sit here and listen to Splinter do the flashback again. this was a weird fun fact from IMDb that I'm sure you guys saw, but okay, so I'll just read it verbatim. So it says, in the 1980s, the first pitch that Kevin Eastman and Peter Laird got was for a film treatment by Roger Corman,
okay,
notorious schlockmeister. The idea was to have the Turtles played by four comedians that were popular at the time, and it lists Gallagher, Sam Kinison, Bobcat Goldthwait, and Billy Crystal. The actors would be dressed in turtle shells and have their arms and legs painted green. And then another treatment they received took the turtles into much more R-rated territory that included a scene with partially nude nuns on roller skates fighting the turtles.
I got to be honest, I'm kind of disappointed we didn't get either of those. I feel like we missed out. So to Brian's point earlier, I mean, they had enough sense to know what to say yes to and what to say no to.
Yeah.
I mean, it's always fascinating when you know the ending of the story, watching people make difficult decisions, but the correct ones that lead to the most, you know.
Brian, I'm reminded of just I don't know if you saw this, but Patty Jenkins just gave this interview like yesterday, yes. where she's talking about walking away from the second Thor movie.
Mm-hmm.
And she's like, it was the hardest decision she ever had to make because, I mean, there's a guaranteed massive paycheck.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
But she was like, I know that I can't do something good with this script and I will get blamed for it.
Yeah. Right. And it must have been the hardest decision in the world. But then now that we know it was the right decision, and then now she's made one of the best superhero movies, it's like, oh, you just got to admire it.
Right.
We got to imagine. Yeah. Oh, no, go ahead.
No, I'm changing subject, but.
No, please. Yeah.
We sort of skipped over the probably worst little bit of exposition that they snuck into the movie when the answering machine is dangling.
Yes, I was thinking
by
about
a burning
that.
Wire. I was thinking about that. In case he happens to hear the message that Nicole got fired.
And he like remembers the name of the guy who called. Oh, yeah. Charles. Yeah. No,
oh, by the way, when I was fighting for my life against an army of ninjas, I took time to listen to your boss fire you. But as a kid, you don't care.
No.
I do love how the movie found a way to turn like April O'Neil and Casey Jones into like Han and Leia.
Yeah. I love this, by the way. Is that Donatello on the side where he's like just a shot of him outside of the house walking and then like, did I step in something? I might have. I don't know. And he just walks away. I didn't remember that watching it the other night.
I don't know how much you guys watched the CG animated series that was on Nickelodeon, which great really series. Good. If you like Ninja Turtles, it's just a fantastic series all really the way good, through. Yeah. But there was a season where it felt like at least like half a season that took place at the farmhouse, and they designed it pretty much verbatim of what you see here.
No kidding.
Like inside and out. It's pretty cool. Like they have to leave the city for reasons that I won't get into because I don't want to spoil it. But they're basically hiding out here, and then a bunch of stuff happens. But they spend like I don't know 6 or 8 episodes, I want to say.
Can we also call out here? So we, within the span of about a minute and a half, we have such 90s like references. Like we have the moonlighting.
Yep. Yep.
You know, it's kind of like moonlighting, isn't it? Which is like a really, really funny line in 1990.
Well, here's what's funny that when they said that, my kids started laughing and I'm like, you don't know what moonlighting is.
You're a phony. Right. Which for people who don't know was a show with Bruce Willis and Sybil Shepherd, and they were like this bickering couple, will they, won't they? They hate each other, but they love each other sort of thing. And then also you have in the garage the whole Gilligan, Marianne Ginger conversation, which was such a thing.
Yeah.
At that time.
Yeah, I feel like that specific conversation stopped happening like maybe 1995.
Right.
I always liked them trading insults according to the alphabet.
Oh, is that what they're doing?
Yeah.
Dude, going down the alphabet. You just blew my mind right now.
Dude, I always thought they were weird insults.
Oh, yeah.
That makes total sense.
Wow.
Yeah.
I feel like a dumbass now.
Lips. Yeah.
I just thought it was weird. I was like, why didn't they come up with, like, use real names we say?
Yeah. No, they're going alphabetically. Yeah. I always thought that was really cool.
How did you pick up on that? Did you just pick up on that, or is that a thing people do?
Dude, I've known that for 30 years.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Sean, you are the splinter of this commentary track.
There aren't really many deleted scenes from this, right? I was reading about scenes that were shot but not used, but they're not on any like Blu-rays or anything, right?
Just
like,
a lot of training.
The alternate ending.
The additional ending, yeah.
Yeah, you can see that on YouTube.
The apple reminded me, because I guess there was something where they were fighting but throwing around an apple and taking bites out of it. I just can't even imagine that working in their costumes. <That's> so weird.
This always looked painful when this thing breaks.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He plays it off well.
Yeah. This is sweet too, right? The bickering brothers, and he's looking out. He's the one keeping the vigil.
You're awake. He's awake. He wants some food. Bring some food.
He reminds me of like Billy Crystal here too, Raph. He's just like, hey, come on.
I know, Leo. Get a grip, huh? I saw this movie, I think, 6 times in the theater. I think this is the movie I saw more than any movie in the theater. Yeah, 6, maybe 7 times. I'm not sure.
By the way, I just want to point out that Elias Koteas was 29 in this movie.
Whoa!
Which is just, it's weird to me to look at that guy and be like, oh yeah, he's 11 years younger than all of us.
Kodak moment.
Kodak moment, yeah.
There's a dated reference, right?
Now he'd be like, let's put it on the gram.
Now, somebody pointed out that, again, I got to be better about citing my facts here, but I guess Michelangelo doesn't have any lines of dialogue in this whole farmhouse sequence. He's got grunts here when he's punching and then when they meditate and stuff, but he doesn't have any actual dialogue. He laughs with the turtle wax bit.
Yeah. I guess, yeah, I was reading that was, he had like a little bit of a bigger arc there where he was really angry. And then Turtle Wax was sort of the letting the air out. Like, oh, he's okay. All right.
Yeah, but yeah. I guess
you see the Archie Comics box, by the way, in the background? I just went out of focus. But
oh, fun.
It makes sense that you want Raph to have that arc.
Yeah, he could get a little full if everybody's arcs are stepping on one another at the.
Yeah.
We should be focusing on Raph.
Looking at Shredder's costume, and then think, I forget which one of you guys just mentioned the toys that made us a few minutes ago, but I, again, as a kid, and even to this day, I was always bummed that there was never like a super cool Shredder toy.
Right.
And then I learned from the toys that made us that they had to fit him in the packaging, which is why
the
80s action figure is hunched over.
Which is so weird. I always even thought it was weird. I
hated that.
Yeah.
It's so funny. I love that stuff. It's like,
yeah,
I'd say like 7 times out of 10, it's like not a creative decision. It's like a function.
So I'm like, and you think about it, like Casey Jones fits in there, but his proportions are very kind of lumpy, like how the turtles are proportioned, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah. Playmates toys had, and I think they're still around. I think they're still like doing turtle stuff, right? But back then, if you remember, like the human turtle figures were they had like bigger heads and smaller bodies.
Mm-hmm,
And what I remember is right around this 1990, the Playmates also did Dick Tracy toys.
That's right.
They looked like the humans in the Turtles line.
Right. I remember that. Yeah.
Dick Tracy commentary coming soon, by the way.
Wait. Oh, Dick Tracy, yeah.
Turtle wax.
But this was, you know, I feel like, you know, the type of fans that we are, like, I mean, we still have, you know, Star Wars, this and that, and whatever. But I remember this was like my last hurrah with like collecting all the toys and all the merchandise and like really, really buying into a property. And I was remembering something I had forgotten. Do you remember when you'd go in those like party stores and they'd have those oversized buttons with like Bart Simpson
or
the Turtles?
Yes.
So I bought one of the characters in this movie, and I remember setting it up on my desk in like fourth grade and like making my little station. Like, I'm ready to learn how to spell, but like I had my button and on my desk. I remember my teacher, he was such a great guy, Mr. Thomas. I remember him being like, hey, so tell me about this button. What are, who are these guys? Brian? We should point out that last scene, by the way, too, where they're playing Trivial Pursuit. Yeah. That is used in Loaded Weapon 1. Remember that?
Wow.
Yeah, Emilio Estevez. I think he goes in the sewers and then he pops up. They sort of superimpose him into that scene where he pops up his head like, where am I? And then he goes back down.
Yeah, and wow, that, you just uncovered a memory. Wow.
That, right. And that was an actual question from Trivial Pursuit too.
Oh, really?
You know what's funny, by the way, is yesterday as I was watching it, like they asked the question, I was like, "Oh, War and Peace," and then I was like, "Wait, I think I know that because of this movie."
Right. Because of this movie, for yeah. sure. Yeah.
Right.
So I just like incepted myself.
That's hilarious.
One Russian novel featuring more than 500 characters is set during the Napoleonic War.
War and Peace.
I love how Raphael like knows that Donatello's going to know the answer as he's reading it.
Oh, is that kind of it? Is that how he's playing it? I didn't even think about that.
It's kind of like, oh, what Russian novel?
That's really funny. I love this scene. This is one of my favorite parts of the whole movie.
Yeah, it's really sincere.
It's mm-hmm. it's sincere, exactly. I love the way that the way they're physical with each other afterwards. They're just kind of like rubbing their arms, you know. And then Mikey is just crying.
Yeah.
And it's such a, like you talk about, oh, he doesn't have any dialogue. Yeah, but we get his character. Like that's Mikey. He's the most open with his emotions. He's the most innocent.
Mm-hmm. And he's the jokester, but like that's his dad.
Yeah.
You know, there's a time he can be serious when it is serious.
Did you guys ever try meditating after seeing this movie?
No.
Just sitting in dark space and just think, I did.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Just to like kind of quiet yourself or like...
I don't know. I was just like, dude, I was just super, I mean, call it obsessed, I guess, but I was
I get it. Yeah.
Thrilled, yeah. After seeing this movie, yeah, I would sometimes just sit in my room.
I remember it's a little different.
My hands out just thinking,
Yeah. Like, well, I remember, like with Star Wars, I mean, you know, seeing Luke train on Dagobah, I'm sure I tried like standing on one hand and all that stuff. Absolutely. Now, I was just thinking, nowadays, I doubt you would spend so much time on April and Casey.
Sure.
And then I couldn't remember. I was like, well, I don't remember the new movies where they had the new one. Yeah. With what's his name? Will Arnett and Megan Fox.
Well, and Stephen Amell was Casey.
Oh, see, I've only seen that once. It's kind of slipped from my
mind. Yeah, Will Arnett was Vernon, right?
No, yes, that's right. He is.
Yeah. Who was a creation from the comic books. Or no, the cartoon.
From the cartoon, yeah.
April?
Yes, that's right, yeah.
That's funny.
I mean, it really
does look like... Sorry, Backlash.
Yeah. It's cool though. It's cool.
It's great.
Lends to the like the comic bookiness, you know.
Yeah, not in a bad way. I just never thought about it, but yeah, I totally see it.
Feels full, but also kind of limited, you know.
Yeah.
I've said before that the second of the Michael Bay produced films, Out of the Shadows, I really like it. I've watched it several times, and I'm like, it's just a great Ninja Turtles movie. I mean, obviously the designs of the turtles are not optimum, but it in much the same way as this, it treats it seriously and makes a movie that like the 10-year-old you would have wanted to see.
Mm-hmm.
Totally.
So what was your reaction then to the second one when it came out? I mean, did you guys, I think I was young enough.
Secret of the Ooze,
still just sort of, yeah. Sorry. Secret of the Ooze, where I would just be like, okay, well this is what I was given.
Yeah. Yeah. And, in the moment. Yeah. For sure.
I didn't think much about it at the time, but I mean, I've revisited it maybe once since it came out.
Yeah,
and only like, once.
I mean, like you know, I probably watched it a handful of times right away when it came out
as a kid. Sure, sure. Oh, I see.
And then from then to now, maybe once I've seen it.
Okay. Yeah.
And I mean, you know, it exists.
Yeah. Yeah.
I did not like that they recast April. I remember that.
Me too. Yeah. I always want consistency.
Yeah. And I thought Paige Turco was fine. Like I don't know. She's fine, but I thought Judith Hogue did a good job in this one and they should have just kept her.
Yeah, she doesn't just feel like there by obligation. Like she feels like a character.
Yeah.
Fully formed character. You know? So yeah.
Although Casey does come back for the third one, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Oh, that's right.
And he's also one of the he's Casey Jones, and then he plays one of the characters in Feudal Japan too.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't remember that one as well.
He's got like a beard, and he's a he's some prisoner that they set free or something. I don't remember. What I remember most about the third movie is they played the Jurassic Park trailer before.
Oh, yeah. Oh, really?
Yeah,
because it came out early 93.
Yep. I didn't understand this as a kid, though. Do you like penicillin on your pizza?
Yeah.
It's like, huh? I don't know.
Trying to look up the budget for this, unless you guys know.
$13.5 million,
I
think. Yeah. Wow. $13
million. Which is low for a studio movie, but it's high for an independent movie.
Yeah.
Opening weekend gross was $25 million in the U.S.
Well, there you go.
made $135 in the U.S. and over $200 worldwide.
So that's a monster success. In any circumstance, a monster success. But in $1990 dollars, that's like, that's all time, you know?
Yeah. Now I'm looking at Secret of the Ooze, which had a bigger budget, $25 million. But it only made $78 million total.
Worldwide?
That's what it says, yeah.
Wow.
$78 million worldwide? Really?
Yeah. I mean, that could be – that is also the same number for domestic, so maybe they don't have the info. Right, but still, I mean, that's quite a drop.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, it came out like the next year.
Yeah.
Yeah, they really rushed it through, yeah.
Yeah.
Now, did anybody ever stop to think about – maybe this was a cut scene or something, but like Danny, how would he know where they lived?
Wait, say that again?
How does Danny know where the Ninja Turtles live?
I just assumed Splinter told him.
Oh.
There you go. That works for me.
There it is.
Splinter's like, hey, can you go to my house? Can you hide my porn? And then...
I could die here.
Yeah.
So two things.
In case something happens to me.
And then, you know, the turtles show back up. That makes sense.
Now this is, Lairdman Island?
Lairdman, yep. Yeah. Nice little Easter egg there.
East Warehouse at Lairdman Island, yep.
Yeah. See, Danny's popular here. The kids like him. Get a little high five. I wonder if that's something him and that actor worked out together. Like, hey, to the director, we got an idea.
He's like, yeah, sure, whatever. They're like so proud of themselves. They created some business.
Whatever, I just got fired.
Yeah, right.
Oh, jeez.
Do we get another story here?
Ooh, where his symbol.
Symbol, yeah.
They're messy. They're a messy bunch.
Yeah, I was trying to look at what it was, just like, is it DVD player? I guess that wouldn't exist yet. But I was like, what is that, like TVs and...
VCRs and stuff, yeah.
Yeah.
Stereo amps.
Right. And he's always wearing a Sid Vicious t-shirt.
Yep.
Even when he changes his shirts.
Because he's a punk, man. He's hardcore.
Oh, he's a punker.
Yeah.
He hates punkers.
Well, that's kind of, I mean, the filmmakers wanted like a much more hard rock soundtrack.
Mm.
And they were basically told, no, you need something more commercial. And that's how you get like Partners in Crime at the end, you know?
Oh, funny.
Zachy, did you ever get the score of this movie? That was like released limited fairly recently.
Never got it.
Got it. I'm sure it's online somewhere. I'm sure you can find it online. Yep.
I mean, I had the tape with the song soundtrack.
Yeah, so did I.
And I mean, geez, yep. Oh my God. Like I feel like if you were, you know, part of the target audience when this movie came out, you still to this day have that rap memorized.
Oh, yeah.
D-U-R-T-L-E.
Yeah, or at least like 2/3 of it, you know?
Yep. Yeah, I like got all giddy when Lin-Manuel Miranda referenced it at the Oscars this year.
Yes, that's right. I forgot about that.
Hi. It's crazy.
This is pretty intense.
Did you guys also have the remember when they did the live tour where like they toured as a concert? Did you have the album
coming out of our shells?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think that was from Pizza Hut, right?
Yep.
Yes.
Yep. I had that. At Six Flags, I saw that live performance of the concert.
Oh, really?
And it was so bad.
Oh, no.
Again, it might have been with Chris Ashline. If Zachy, if you hear from him.
Chris, let us know.
Yeah. We were and it was kind of one of those moments where we realized, at least at the time, like maybe we're a little too old for this, because that was like 93 or 4, it felt like.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It might have been like right before or right after the beginning of high school. Probably right totally before, like maybe 8th grade.
So at that point, you're like, uh-oh. maybe not.
It is funny. I went on a deep dive because I rewatched all three movies a couple of years ago. And then, you know, you go on YouTube and you revisit all this stuff and you see the gradual decline of the quality of suits and, yeah, you know,
literally I gotta remember everything.
Looking at one of those music videos. It's pretty rough.
Yeah, the Turtles, it's kind of interesting because they had their original run was probably about 10 years, 88 to 98.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And then it's kind of interesting how it went away. And then, you know, like 03, it comes back and it's just never gone away since then.
Mm. Yeah.
And the studio, I mean, by now it's owned by Viacom. They figured out, like, just refresh it every couple of years.
Right.
And then we just keep putting juice in the tank, you know?
We're in the hiatus right now. I think that other show got canceled, right?
Did it? Rise of the Ninja Turtles?
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, I think
I didn't know it got canceled.
I think so. I'm sure they still have episodes to air, but I think production has halted on that.
I mean, it didn't look very good from what I saw.
No, again, and we talk about this all the time, like when they do that kind of stuff. Like, we have our versions that we love, so if that's a new thing they want to try, then go for it, you know?
Right.
So Danny's got excellent hearing. Smitty, remember the guy that you've known for 5 seconds?
They're going to kill Splinter.
I love Casey's reaction when he sees Splinter is so great.
Yeah.
He's like, okay. yeah, sure. All right. So now, if this was shot in a real street, I mean, we got these actors just diving into the sewer. That's kind of nuts. Right?
I was just about to say, like, hats off to these stunt people, you know?
Yeah, and this is kind of one of those genius things, too, though. I forget, some recent movie I was thinking about this, where you can keep using the same 10 guys because they have masks on.
Yeah, yep. And like this, this is all just editing, you know?
Right. Kind of just fill the room with smoke and add some funny sound effects.
Yeah, it's like the fight scene at the beginning that's all just over black, you know?
Right.
But you don't think about it. Like, you see that moment and you're like, wow, they kicked ass.
Mm-hmm. It's kind of funny too with Raphael eating that apple. And then supposedly there was that cut scene with the apple. And then Casey was eating the apple. I'd like to see a picture of the screenwriter while he was working. There's just a bowl of apples next to him. He's like, the scene needs something. Who are you?
Change your name to Apple O'Neill.
Yeah, right.
Enough with the apples, Gary.
A friend.
His breath must be so bad.
Splinter?
Yeah.
You know what's funny, guys? I remember shortly after the movie came out, you know, they would always have those 900 numbers related to random things. So they had like the Turtle Power 900 number.
Scam. And
it was just total bullshit.
Scam for kids.
It totally was. Because here's what it was. It's like, you can call this number and hear songs from the soundtrack.
Oh, that's so funny. Not even as inventive as the Corey hotline. At least he was coming up with rhymes.
Allegory. Montessori.
I love this, by the way. You have this collection of people behind Tatsu, and one of them is kind of like an 8-year-old.
Yeah.
You got like all these warriors and this one kid. Like. And apparently one of the people that's the last cameo. I think the guy who plays Leonardo.
That's right. Yes.
You know, watching this now, like, again, hats off to Elias Koteas. We're not actually seeing them. We just keep cutting back to, like, close-ups of a fist flying in. And
except for that. Right there.
Punching him off screen. He's going for it, man.
Right.
He's putting his body and arms away. Yeah.
My mom did not like this scene because she was like, boys, you know, that would kill someone. When he takes the golf club and whacks him in the head.
And you guys, like, slowly, quietly put your golf clubs down.
Right.
Right, see, right. Again, I remember watching this with my dad as a kid, and he's like, he should have used an iron. But that, he's coming from, like, you know, just having watched Commando or something. Right, right. This is how you kill a guy. You know, like,
you know, if you stick a pipe through his chest, smoke will come out of it. That was one of my first R-rated images I think I saw as a kid, and I was like, ah!
Yeah, I had that same reaction. I mean, earlier in the film, when John Matrix, like, cuts off a dude's arm with a hatchet.
Right.
It's just, like, blood squirting everywhere.
Hilarious.
Family? Call this family?
First Junior.
We have loyalty to the Shredder. Oscar clip.
Right.
Dude. That would, like, if he ever gets nominated for an Oscar again, like, that would be such a fun prank to pull at the Oscars, and somebody right. just airs this. Sam Rockwell.
Right. I mean, or at least it's some lifetime achievement.
Yeah, so great.
The thing is, Sam Rockwell is one of these actors who is good in, like, everything he does, right?
Absolutely, yeah.
But if you would have said, like, back then, that guy right there is going to be the one who has the most high-profile career.
Yeah.
Like, right. What? Right. Yeah.
But the truth is, if I had the opportunity, that's what I'd want to talk to him about. I'd be like, "You talked about making Ninja Turtles."
Yeah.
Totally.
Yeah.
Because it was probably at a time. Well, it was at a time where I'm sure he had no idea where he was going to eventually end up.
Right.
But then also being in this blockbuster movie. I mean, that must have been a really interesting time for him.
I wonder if people, you know, it's like, it reminds me of, like, Frank Langella playing Skeletor, right?
Mm.
And it's very funny because, like, you always see interviews with him where somebody's like, there's one movie I have to ask you about. He's like, is it Masters of the Universe? Like, he knows based on the age of the person.
Right, right.
And he's, like, down because he enjoyed playing that role.
Yeah.
So I wonder if Sam Rockwell is like that about this.
Yeah. It was kind of fun.
Yeah.
And bantering back and forth. It was a shell of a good hit.
Yeah, see, we're getting sucked into it.
Oh, no, I'm just thinking. Yeah, I know. Now I'm absorbed in watching them fight. I don't know. I'm trying to decide. Like, I guess at the time, this probably seems super violent, but it's like all just kind of punching. And
it.
And I remember Batman at the same time came out, and everyone was like, what the heck is this? This is so violent.
I really like both of those movies, Batman and this. Maybe it's because we were the ones watching it at that age.
Yeah,
so it just was what it was. Yeah,
like, that's at the baseline for what we consider violent, you know, or not.
Yeah, that's a bad point.
But I mean, I watched it with my kids yesterday. I'm like, I don't know. I don't see anything in here that's that bad, you know?
No.
Yeah. I'm sure me and my brother were probably just doing, like, flips in the yard after watching it.
Yeah.
Not like we were trying to.
Do you guys remember that in the trailer, that shot that we just passed with Michael, where Michelangelo's head retracts into his shell?
Yes.
That was, like, the closing of the original trailer, and it was a totally different voice. It was like, I love being a turtle.
Really?
Yeah.
Is that online?
Probably you could find it. I'm sure
you can. That'd be, yeah. I guess at that point, they're like, pick up the red phone, get me Cousin Oliver.
Yeah, I wonder if that was, like, on-set audio or something.
Probably.
Or just some like, editorial assistant, like, just, I don't know, throw in some scratch.
Right there, too. He made a Three Stooges reference. Who's going to get that anymore, you know?
That's a good point. Well, I'm doing my best to keep that alive, Sean.
Because love the Stooges.
I watch the Stooges with the boys. One thing I remember thinking at the time, and I still feel, is Shredder is not particularly imposing physically.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-mm.
And I find that somewhat distracting. He just seems like kind of like a skinny dude with that weird stuff on. Like, the helmet seems too big for his head.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. They needed James Avery to do his voice. That's what was missing.
Yeah, yeah.
Hey!
I do love all this stuff, though. Like,
Matchport. It's funny.
Like, they're still themselves, even though they've got this unstoppable, scary opponent.
I appreciate, like, I mean, we're so well-versed in this, you know, the mythology and these characters and stuff like that. But, like, you really appreciate, they understood who these characters were, the filmmakers, you know?
Yes, cared.
The performers, cared. Too. The performers, just, they're, like, there are actors acting out these characters under there. Their voices
get
done.
But real quick, like, I love that Shredder is just standing there in the back. Like waiting them.
Well, they have like some sort of like huddle.
He's just chilling. Okay, you got it figured out. Okay, here we go.
Okay.
Sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you, Sean.
No. I was just like you know, it because it's so good, we don't stop to appreciate that these are the guys in the suits are giving like performances. They're not just moving around and they're not just fighting and stuff. Like they're giving actual performances with their bodies and their you know their body language and the whole deal. But it's so good.
Yeah.
Look at that raft.
Yeah. Right.
I mean that's.
So the fight footage was sped up or slowed down?
23 frames a second, I think it was. Yeah. Or maybe that was just the talking was 23 frames a second?
Yeah, that was specific. I think both of them weren't, you know, significant. Yeah.
Okay. But just like a frame here or there.
Smoother. Yeah.
Okay.
We got the making a murderer moment that'll pay off in a little bit.
Wait, where's April?
Yeah, we haven't seen her. Wow. Yeah. I think the next time we see her is when she's telling Casey to kiss her. Right? I think, right?
Yeah. Just kind of lost track of her hair.
You know what was cool as a kid is like, obviously there's like the cliches now that you can throw at it. Like, why are they all like, why don't they just fight him at the same time? Uh-huh. But the fact that Leonardo is the only one that gets like a legit strike on the shredder.
Mm-hmm.
I remember watching that when I was younger and being like, yeah, that makes sense. Like he would be the one to get.
Right.
You know, to get a hit on him.
Well, I mean, even like what I remember from playing the Nintendo game was like, you either want to be Donatello or Leo.
Yeah.
Because they had the long reach weapons. Yeah,
exactly. Like, you just figured that out. So, like, the Psy, I feel like, is the most useless unless you're in close combat.
Because it's supposed to be it's more of like a defense weapon against katana blades.
Yes.
You know, we didn't ask. Does anybody have a favorite Ninja Turtle?
Oh, man.
I mean, probably Michelangelo, honestly. Just because he's fun. I think the nunchucks. I had nunchucks as a kid. I was that guy.
I think Leo was always my favorite just because he's a leader. Like, I don't like it when they do versions where he's not the leader.
Right. Mm. I liked Raphael. I always liked Raphael.
He's more of like wisecracking in the cartoon, right?
Yeah.
Less like moody.
In the arcade game, I always play either Raphael or Michelangelo, though.
Mm.
Those arcade games are so great. I'm so glad I got that Raspberry Pi.
Oh, man, I know. It's been great during this moment in time. You know, it's funny because, this is like really dramatic.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? For not being a big spectacular bonanza of a set piece. You know what I mean? But it's all the drama's there. And then also it's Shredder hanging over the ledge here. And I love that Shredder implements his own demise here by throwing the blade.
That's always the trope, right? You have to have the villain die, but you can't have the hero kill them.
Yep. Except the hero's best friend.
Yeah, he can do it.
This. Right. He's just legit murdered the guy.
Yeah. He says, oops, so you laugh about it.
I don't know. That'd actually be funny if they did cut to all the foot recruit kids going like, ugh.
It'd be, and you would just hear him going, ah, ah! Right. Just very
maybe
slowly.
That's what the director did before they let him go.
Suddenly the cops show up. I mean, there's been a pitched ninja battle for a solid hour.
Like a scene out of the Warriors or something.
There's your buddy, Sean.
Danny's Redemption. That's what the chapter is called in the DVD, I imagine.
Trust me.
You know what's kind of funny? It's validating. I think last night I kept calling Danny a wiener, and my girlfriend's like, what is wrong like with you? Like, and it's really validating hearing you guys back me up.
Are you okay? Are you okay, Danny?
Dan. It's just Dan now.
Dan? I love the way he says that.
There it goes.
It's nice.
It's uplifting. Anybody can be redeemed.
That's right.
What was the name of Ernie Reese Jr., his character in the second movie? Like,
He's the
Pino?
Something like that. He's the pizza guy.
Yeah, but I remember, you know, I always hate when they have to throw some sort of human sidekick or kid into the mix, but I remember kind of liking him, actually. Am I wrong?
He was really great. He was a kick-ass martial artist, which made him cool, you know?
Right. But I remember him kind of fun, and like his banter with them felt natural.
Yeah, he's the Donatello stunt actor in this one.
Right.
And before this, he had been on a show. Like, the first time I ever saw him was this show in the early 80s called Sidekicks.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
With Gil Gerard, who was Buck Rogers.
Wow. So you're going to point that out, Sean.
What's it?
You're going to point out the moment, the location, I think. Oh, you said something about here it is, or?
Oh, no. It was the, I forget. What were we just watching?
It was when Sam Rockwell was about to talk to the cops. I thought you were going to point out the
Easter. I was just going to do my impression, but we passed it. Go check out the East Warehouse over at Labman Island. You get your answers there.
So I wonder how many kids watched this movie and were like, yeah, that's how you get a girl. Like, just be a sexist pig and she'll ask you to kiss her. Like, you know.
I know. Give her a massage without asking.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, right. Jeez. Here we go.
Awesome.
Bitchin. That's a...
Yeah, I don't think I ever even got that till I was way older, because he says it so weird, too.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, it's like a kid who's swearing for the first time, and you have to
delicious.
Put a little sparkle on it.
Yeah.
Comes the big finish.
Yeah.
Cowabunga.
I made a funny. You know, speaking of like things that that was the first time I ever heard someone say, I made a funny. But also too. Earlier in the movie when April's like, oh, your dad is going to have kittens. Like, this is the first time I ever heard.
Yeah,
and And I say that like all the time now.
Oh, really? Oh, that's funny.
That's because of this movie.
Now I can hear T-U-R-T-L-E power.
Okay, so I need to point out the one thing about this song that absolutely infuriates me and has for 30 years.
What's that?
And it is this. Raphael is not the leader of the group.
No, he's not.
Right.
It's like, how do you get that wrong?
It does mention
gotta be the syllables. They're like, well, the syllables work.
Mentions the Lone Ranger, though, Zachy.
It does. And Tonto. Right. But yeah, I mean, as I was watching it yesterday with the kids, even... Full.
This day and age, who could ask for more? The crime wave is high with muggings mysterious. All police and detectives are curious because they can't find the force.
Are we doing this?
This legally evil force.
I guess we are.
Anyway, sorry, what were you saying, Zach?
No, even as I was watching it with the kids, they were like, wait, Raphael's not the leader. I'm like, I know, son, I know. Welcome to my silent pain for 30 years.
That's hilarious. Songwriter's probably just watching the credits. Oh, he's listed first. I don't know.
I guess. Probably, yeah.
This is interesting. I was reading about how Judith Hogue was friends with Robin Williams. And he was a big Ninja Turtles fan. So
I like that.
Yeah, and so he gave her the comics to read. Like, he had all the comics.
That's so great.
That's like a random thing, right?
Yeah. That's fun. As I like to point out in the commentaries, I worked on this one movie, and there's a woman who's kind of a legend in background voice acting, like all the whole Loop Group sort of thing. And she's done everything. So when I watch these older movies when I was a little kid who never even imagined I'd be working on movies, I like to look for her name just to see if she had worked on it. And sure enough, Barbara Harris. She's
like, wow.
Unbelievable career she's had.
Huh.
Everything.
Given Robin Williams was a fan, like, I wonder if they would have tried to get him in the movie.
Had they known that, yeah.
Right?
Or maybe they actually tried to, they wanted him, they gave him the offer to play Shredder, but it was actually just to get James Sato.
to come down. Yeah.
That's why Robin Williams is really upset about this whole thing. This is just the story of studios screwing Robin Williams over constantly.
I could see a version where Robin Williams plays the David Warner character in the second movie.
Oh, sure, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Or even if he, like, even like a Baxter Stockman or something like that.
Right.
So here's my question. The song that comes after this, which is 9.95,
which
is the most 1990 song I've ever heard in my life.
Yeah.
However, what does that mean, 9.95?
I know, it's funny when Donatello says it shamelessly on the roof.
Is it the Richter scale? Is it something to do with earthquakes? Like, that's a 9.95?
Is it?
I don't know.
I don't know, because you think they'd either say 10 or, of course, like 11, right?
Right.
But it's like 9.95 is so specific.
Yeah. Like, what's the turtle connection to that?
I don't know. Maybe this. You know, the song probably already existed.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, I like it. It's a good song.
Yeah.
But yeah, I remember like Hammer, MC Hammer's on the soundtrack. And
Vanilla Ice is on the next one.
There's
been a Daryl Hall and a Mike Hall in the credits, Brent.
Yeah, I saw a Jerry Hall also. This is my culture.
These are your people.
There's a Coddle, Virginia Coddle. It's kind of like Coddle.
I doubt it has a commentary, but I would really love to hear a commentary about how this movie was made, because I'm sure, you know, without the technology we have now, I'm sure there's a lot of great stories.
I think it still holds up, man. I mean, it's cheesy and it's hokey at times, and there's a lot of cliches in this movie. But it's good. It's got some visual flair. Like, the characters are pretty well realized, I thought.
Yeah, that was my experience too. I thought it still feels like a kid's movie.
Yeah.
But not in a bad way. You know, it knows its audience, but it is well thought out, and it's everything's considered. You know, it's not just there to make a buck.
Exactly.
I think that earnestness gets you a lot of the way.
Mm-hmm.
And the fact that, you know, we all have those movies that we liked as kids, and then you come back to it as an adult and you're kind of like, ugh, I don't know about that. Right? and the truth is, I mean, this, you know, while watching it, especially last night, I tried to shut off 10-year-old me.
Mm-hmm,
and just take it as it existed right now. And I've still found myself pulled in.
Yeah.
Because there is, I mean, there's just, there's a heart underneath, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And I think there's so many lessons you can take away from this, but I think that's a big one. I think it's unfortunate that it was deemed violent enough or whatever, that like the toy people didn't want to have anything to do with it, whatever. And so as a result, it's just like Batman, right? You ended up having weaker sequels because of the fears of the merchandising people.
Yeah.
You know, and there we go. That was Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles 1990. This has been a track long and coming, but we made it.
Dude, that was so much fun.
Yeah. That was a blast. Yeah.
Thanks to you guys for scheduling time for this. And thanks to everybody listening for listening along. Hopefully we made it worth your while.
Absolutely.
Quarantine time continues. So we got plenty more commentaries coming, and I'm kind of excited myself to see what we decide to talk through, in the weeks and months ahead. But, as we wrap things up, Sean, what do you have going on?
Yeah, man. Still executive producing, show running on Puppy Dog Pals, which, we are still working on. It's pretty amazing. Everybody is working. Everybody on the crew here in Los Angeles is working remotely, which is pretty fantastic. And stuff is just finding a way to, you know, the train keeps moving. We're doing more episodes of Puppy Dog Pals. So check it out.
And Brian, I mean, we know you're working on Puppy Dog Pals. So how about this? What's like one new thing you've done while you're stuck inside?
One new thing I've done. I don't know. It's funny because I have been. I turned in two scripts yesterday. It's been kind of a business has been business as usual. I've sort of now that those are in. This was my first sort of fun thing I've been able to do. So I'm sort of looking forward to. I don't know. I'll cook something new.
I got a question. Sure.
Yes.
When was the last time either one of you wore like jeans?
Oh my gosh, dude! It's been 20 plus days at this point.
Ever since the hunkering down, I've been in sweatpants and pajama pants and flannelly stuff, and yep. I have not put on a pair of like proper pants.
So my second kid, he's 11. like 2 days ago, I come downstairs. It's the middle of the day. I'm wearing like pajama pants, and he goes, "Sir, are you planning to wear pants again?"
Really?
Yeah. So I'm like, it's hard to be pissed at this kid, you know?
Yeah, that's pretty funny.
I hope to one day wear jeans again. But for now, the pajamas continue.
Yep, same.
Please, if you guys have any comments on this commentary, please let us know what you thought of the movie, what you thought of what we had to say, etc. You know, we always want to hear what you have to say. And again, if you've got any suggestions, we've been getting plenty of suggestions, by the way, about movies people want to hear us talk through. So please keep those coming. You can email us at moviefilmpodcast@gmail.com. You can also hit like on our Facebook page, facebook.com/moviefilmpodcast, and message us through there. As always, please go to iTunes and leave a review, leave a star rating. Every little bit helps. And if you're looking for me, you can find me at my website, zackiescorner.com. That's Zakis Corner. That's also my Twitter. That's also my Instagram. And on behalf of my partner, Brian Hall, and of course, special guest, Sean Coyle, my name is Zaki Hassan. This has been our Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles commentary track. But we'll be back soon. Thanks, everybody, for listening.
On the half shell, they're the heroes for. In this day and age, who could ask for more? The crime wave is high, with muggings mysterious. All police and detectives are furious, because they can't find the source of this lethally evil force. This is serious, so give me a quarter. I was a witness, get me a reporter. Call April O'Neill in on this case. Hey, you better hurry up, there's no time to waste. We need help like quick on the double. Have pity on the city, man, it's in trouble. We need heroes like the Lone Ranger. When Tonto came pronto, when there was danger. They didn't say we'd be there in half an hour, cause they displayed turtle power. Reporter was hot on the trail, determined to put these crooks in jail. She spied the bad guys and saw what happened, but before she knew it, she fell in a trap and got caught. Yeah, she was all alone, with no friends and no phone. Now this was beyond her worst dreams, cause she was cornered by some wayward teens. Headed by Shredder, they were anything but good. Misguided, unloved, they called them the Foot. They could terrorize and be angry youth, and they'd mug the people who needed proof. Then from out of the dark came an awesome sound. Shout a cowabunga as they hit the ground. From the field of weeds, the heroes rescued the flower, cause they possess turtle power. Find the strength to do what's right. That's turtle power.
Heroes on a half shell, they're on a mission. When there's a battle, got the enemy wishing that they stayed at home. Instead of fighting these ninja masters with moves like lightning, they were once normal, but now they're mutants. Splinter's the teacher, so they are the students. Leonardo, Michelangelo, and Donatello make up the team with one other fellow, Raphael. He's the leader of the group, transformed from the norm by the nuclear goop. Pizza's the food that's sure to please. These ninjas are into pepperoni and cheese. Back to the story, it's not hard to find. Ninjas not just of the body, but of the mind. Those
through the words that the master instructed. But a letter from Shredder had Splinter abducted. That was the last straw, spring into action. Step on the foot, now they're gonna lose traction. Now this is for real, so you fight for justice. Your shell is hard, so you shout, they can't dust us off. Like some old coffee table, since you've been born, you've been willing and able to defeat the snake, protect the weak, fight for rights and your freedom to speak. Now the villain is chilling, so you make a stand. Back to the wall, put your sword in your hand. Remember the words of your teacher, your master. Evil moves fast, but good moves faster than light. Shining for your illumination, good versus evil equals confrontation. So when you're in trouble, don't give in and go sour. Try to rely on your eternal power.
Hey guys, it is Ryan. I'm not sure if you know this about me, but I'm a bit of a fun fanatic when I can. I like to work, but I like fun too. It's a thing. And now the truth is out there. I can tell you about my favorite place to have fun. Chumba Casino. They have hundreds of social casino style games to choose from with new games released each week. You can play for free anytime, anywhere. And each day brings a new chance to collect daily bonuses. So join me in the fun. Sign up now at ChumbaCasino.com.
No purchase necessary. VGW. Void where prohibited by law. See terms and conditions. 18 plus.
It is Ryan here, and I have a question for you. What do you do when you win? Like, are you a fist pumper, a woohooer, a hand clapper, a high fiver? I kind of like the high five, but if you want to hone in on those winning moves, check out Chumba Casino. At ChumbaCasino.com, choose from hundreds of social casino style games for your chance to redeem serious cash prizes. There are new game releases weekly, plus free daily bonuses. So don't wait. Start having the most fun ever at ChumbaCasino.com.
No purchase necessary. VGW. Void where prohibited by law. See terms and conditions. 18 plus.